Many people ask me, MM2K, why do you promote Stadia so much? It has a smaller library to other ecosystems. It doesn't have a large player base at the moment. What makes it so special now because of all this? We answer all those questions on what makes it a great experience now and what will make it excel past anything we've ever expected from gaming in the future. Let's get into it.
They sick cause I follow my gut. They say I was pushing my luck. I'ma push me a matte all black truck. Oh, I'm not sorry.
What's up, people? It is your boy MM2K back again with another video. Do me a huge favor, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, rock those bells for notifications, please, so you know when your boy's dropping these doses. I appreciate all of y'all straight up because y'all know the deal, y'all know the reason, and y'all know the slogan. I am not too proud to ask. Let's get into it. All right. So again, as I alluded to in the mock-up or the bumper in this video, right? Why am I capping, quote unquote, so much for Stadia? Small lineup, games we've already played, old games, not the largest player base, you know what I mean? And many other things that those things that are being said are true, but then there's a lot of muck and stuff that's being thrown my way, which isn't true. And I just say, go to my older videos for all the misconceptions and all of this stuff. I just want to base this off of the questions that are sensible, right? And I completely understand. This is something brand new. It's aiming to achieve something that has never been attempted before. And people have a difficulty of wrapping their thoughts around something beyond the first 5 minutes of now, as I like to say, right? So in order for me to explain all that, what makes it great now, why I think it has a promising future, something worth investing in definitely, and why it's become my primary way to game, in order for me to break that down adequately, I gotta break it down into four pillars. The first pillar is understanding how the platform is built. Then talking about the launch and pushbacks. Then talking about the future. And then talking about why I think it's just a silly notion to compare what Stadia is doing to dedicated devices and having expectations put upon it on other ecosystems that have been around for decades. All right. So first, let's talk to try to understand where I'm coming from on why I like it now, why I think it has a very promising future. We got to start with how the platform was built to get a novice, at least, understanding of where I'm coming from. Okay. So for those of you that are not aware, Stadia, it took Stadia 9 years to develop. You know, it's based off of an approach similar to OnLive, even though OnLive required you to have a game client, I believe, installed on your computer. This is working directly, Stadia, that is, when I say this, is working directly off the cloud. It is pinging from its server blades to a receiving point on your computer, or via a streaming device. This is solely streaming. This is cloud. You can't get any more cloud than this, right? Now, in order to create that scenario, you gotta have data. Data is very key here, right? And people may be asking, maybe rather, I should start off by saying, why would you even wanna have a scenario like that? Well, first and foremost, You don't have to worry about hacking and hack bots and stuff like that. Like what you see on the screen right now, it's an article from Digital Foundry. And I know I've said I don't want Digital Foundry around anything Stadia does, but the quote-unquote article has already been written. So therefore, we're going to turn lemons into lemonade, and we're going to take the things that Digital Foundry had to acknowledge based upon the facts that they couldn't deny anymore, what they had to acknowledge in this most recent write-up, right? And hopefully it's the last write-up, because again, I still wholeheartedly believe they need to stay away from this because they don't have the know-how, nor do they have the gumption to fully understand what this presents and be in a way to evaluate it wholeheartedly and properly all the way through. That said, the game that you see advertised here, Players Unknown Battlegrounds, a lot of people are praising the Stadia version over everywhere else. First and foremost, they're praising it over consoles because it still looks great. You know what I'm saying? In the quality mode, and you're getting 60 frames per second in the quality mode, right? Then on top of that, okay, it may look better on PC, but on PC, you're not getting the cheat box and the aim box and all that other stuff. Because this is solely based on the cloud, you eliminate all of the cheating that you see elsewhere. So that's one benefit of being solely placed in the cloud and just streaming from one point to another point, right? Secondly, it makes it a lot more mobile. This can be played on any screen that you pretty much have in your home, or any type of screen, just by a click of a button. Boop, boop, now it's on my phone. Boop, boop, I'm back upstairs. Boop, boop, now it's on my TV. As simple as that, and I have videos demonstrating this, so definitely check out my channel, to see those videos in action, right? So those are just some of the premier factors on building a cloud, sole cloud solution. Then, on top of that, you have something called frictionless gaming that allows you to do things that you can't do when you integrate dedicated devices too much. This is something that Microsoft themselves spoke to at their GamerStack in 2020. It's called frictionless gaming, and they've admitted there are things that can be done in a cloud that are not even possible on the strongest dedicated device, all right? Frictionless gaming, look it up. I didn't make that up. It's an actual term that refers to cloud gaming. Check it out. So those are the reasons why you would want to create a sole cloud solution, right? And in order to do this again, Google had to work at this for 9 years, and then they were able to present us with Project Stream. Once we got Project Stream, which allowed us to demo Assassin's Creed Odyssey over the internet, and then I gave Google back crucial data, 24,000 hours worth of crucial data, they were able to create Stadia 1.0. With Stadia 1.0, they then had a platform that they could launch to the public that would give them more data to help them build the ultimate prize, which is Stadia 2.0. Because Stadia's goal is to be able to rock and compete with the Xbox and the PlayStation and anything else out there. But because this is a sole cloud gaming solution with those sole cloud gaming benefits, the frictionless gaming, the obsolete nature of cheating, and the mobility and the convenience, in order for you to get all that, they need data. They don't have a box sitting in front of them with closed off static scenarios. They need a lot of data because this is implementing your network in order to make that happen. So Stadia 1.0 sole purpose is to get Stadia to the point to upgrade to 2.0, right? But even while they're doing that, they're still providing you a great experience all the way around. They're giving you games that people say, oh, these are games I played elsewhere, but you ain't played them like this, baby. Like I said, I gave you an example with PUBG. But Borderlands 3 is buttery smooth on Stadia. I love it on Stadia. I didn't have to deal with the Epic Game Store. I can't stand that store because it's god-awful. And then I didn't have to deal with the stuttering 30 frames per second or the underperforming performance mode on consoles. I'm enjoying Borderlands 3. It is a great experience on Stadia. Division. Division 2 on Stadia is the premier experience to play it anywhere, even over PCs. I don't care. Because of that Stream Connect feature as well, you ain't got to spend a whole bunch of money to get that 60 frames per second, and you get great fidelity, and you get it at 4K 6, baby. You can't beat that, man. You can't beat it. So that's what's making the platform great now. And that brings me on to the next pillar, the launch and pushbacks. Well, people say, hold on, because the lineup is limited. Well, we can't have short-term memory. We gotta remember that the lineup was supposed to be more robust than this. How so? Well, Doom was the launch in 2019, in December, a month after, not even really a full month, after the platform was launched. Then Cyberpunk was supposed to come right around the corner in 2020, followed up by Marvel. So this whole talk about, well, they ain't got nothing but old games, that would have been thrown out the window, because three of the biggest games over a 12 to 18 month period were supposed to come out as early, starting in December, a month, less than a month after the platform launch. If those things would have fell into place the way they were supposed to, as far as Stadia is concerned, it would be a completely different conversation. All right. So that, you know, that great lineup that was supposed to be there, it kind of hurt the platform. You know what I mean? That being said, why do I think the future is bright despite all that? Xbox Series X is coming out. PlayStation 5 is coming out. Those are the main, the big two. How can Stadia survive in such a crowded lineup or such a crowded field as far as gaming is concerned? Well, I'm going to tell you this. Generation 2.0 is supposed to be 8K 120. All right. And as long as they continue to get this data that they so need to get it there, which I believe that, look, if they can create 4K 60 with just 24,000 hours of data off of just one game, imagine what they're doing now, full retail, with people purchasing games and buying games and the growing inventory that they have now. 2.0 is going to be fantastic, all right? And with that said, you know what I'm saying? You also have a developer that came out and said, hey, my experience with the Generation 2.0 version of Stadia, I'm getting better performance and it's easier for me to develop for it than it is the Xbox Series X. And as we all know, on paper, the Xbox Series X is a monster. So that's saying a lot. Now, with all that said, you cap it all off with the fact that Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox himself, for a reason, said that his main competitors right now are Google and Amazon because they're positioned to get the billions of gamers that he wants to get a hold of. And these people like Phil Spencer have access to information that we wish we had. We can't even imagine. So he's seeing something that we don't see because he's coming from the boardroom where all the information is at. And there's a reason why he's saying that, all right? So that's why I feel that the future is bright, okay? We've already covered how the platform is built so you can understand what they're trying to accomplish, what's the benefits of what they're trying to accomplish, and why the games presented now, even though they're a little bit more limited at this moment, they're gonna grow, come on. But even though that they're limited, it provides a lot better experience with those same games than you've experienced elsewhere. Why the whole small lineup narrative would have been different if the plans would have went as they expected. But, you know, bumps happen all the time. The platform's only 5, 6, 7 months old. You know, give it some time. It's going to grow its lineup. And why I think the future is great. Now, and I think the future is great again because of what they're presenting with 2.0 and what developers have already said about Google Stadia 2.0. Now, I want to address this thing about, well, Stadia isn't great, or it's not promising at all because it sucks because it didn't launch with that AAA exclusive. And I get two scenarios brought to me. First and foremost, Nintendo Switch with Breath of the Wild, and then I get thrown at me Halo Infinite, or not Halo Infinite, but the original Halo on the original Xbox. First with Switch. Look, it's just silly to expect a AAA game in the lines of Zelda, a franchise that has been here for decades, has been around longer than most people that are listening to this have been born. You know what I'm saying? So we're not even going to go. That's a silly conversation. It doesn't make any sense. Kudos to Nintendo for, again, continuing their multi-decade tradition and having IP that they've built up, again, for a time longer than people have been born. But the more fathomable question is, well, hold on. Xbox, when they released, had Halo, one of the biggest games of all time, as a launch title. Where's Google Stadia's Halo? And I say, okay, I get you. But you got to understand, and I beckon back to the first pillar where I talked about how this thing was built. They did not know what they were building for, what the Stadia developers would be building for until 2019, when they got Project Stream out there, took all that valuable data and was able to calibrate the system. That's why they didn't even put a studio together until 2019. So people can ask about that. Well, then why launch in 2019? You know, why not launch, you know, when you get to AAA game? Because, again, as I spoke to earlier, that platform, this platform, which is Stadia, is based upon data. The real kit and caboodle for them is 2.0. You don't launch a 2.0 without data for 1.0. And why would you launch a 2.0 after Xbox and PlayStation's already out? You're already at a disadvantage and you're playing catch up forever. So 2019 was pristine for them to launch. Makes perfect sense, right? And secondly, because you don't know, you haven't reached a certain plateau yet. If you develop, if you put together a team, let's say you put together a team in 2015, 2016, 2017. This is a cloud gaming experience. So things are being updated on the fly. You don't have specs for a particular box that you're developing for, because as you get more and more data in, you're always improving what the platform is capable of. So the team starts developing for something in 2015. And then in 2016, 2017, it's now capable of this. So now you got to scrap that and go to the drawing board. So then you start developing again for something that it can do now in 2017. But then Project Stream comes out and you get all this crucial data and it now is capable of this. So now you got to scrap all that and start all over again. And then in 2019, you start developing again. But then because of all the data that is presented at 1.0, you know what I'm saying? That you got to scrap it. You see what I'm saying? So in the first few years of it being out, you got to let the platform build itself up from the data that's being presented to a certain plateau, and then you can build from that. And they're starting now in 2019 after they've got to 1.0, because they said, okay, we can see ourselves in X amount of time being able to do this. We'll build up for that, and that will be ahead of what we're capable of today. But by the time we finish this project, we'll have all the I's dotted, all the T's crossed, and this thing will blow people's minds. In the meantime, what we're going to do is we're going to do what Xbox did in its most successful generation, which isn't the original Halo generation, the 360 generation. We're going to lean on our second party relationships, because those are the talent, that experienced talent that's already out there, that have already cohesively worked together, that can make the best games right now. We're going to fund those experiences, get those heavily rated games into our ecosystem, get exclusive games or exclusive content from them while we're building up our first party studios cohesiveness. And then by the time they get something together, it'll be able to blow your mind. But in the interim, people will still get exclusive experiences and content via our second party relationships. And that's already been proven to be a winning success, a winning formula, because Xbox did it with the 360. Xbox's problem is they just didn't have a first party backup, but Stadia has that as well. They already built the studios and they're at work right now. So that's why I think that it's kind of silly to make that comparison of what happened with studios decades ago. I mean, that have been around for decades, and not understanding what the platform is capable of in the future, right? So with that said, that's it from your boy MM2K. Hey, yo, let me know what you think about what I had to say in the comment section below, because like I always say, who cares what I think? But if you did like what I had to say, check out the links below to follow me. Those links will lead you to the Broadband Bullies, PNTS Network, Hard Knock Digital Culture, and yes, here the Stadia Dosage. With all that being said, hey, look, guys, don't take my word for it. Stadia is available for free. Check it out. If you're running into any issues, which I've had a few people come to me and say, hey, you know, this ain't working like how it works for you. I see. What do I do? Been able to help them out. Just come give me a ring, or I'll get you connected with somebody that can help you if I can't. And if you appreciate all that, please like, sub, and share this information out. You all have a wonderful, wonderful gaming day. Peace.